Well, good morning, everyone. What a pleasure to see a full crowd here tonight. I mentioned to President Postol earlier that I was worried about the crowd showing up, and he said, don't worry, they will be here. So it's like Field of Dreams or something. They will come. We built it. So thank you for coming out, braving the roads this morning. My name is Gary Gregg. I'm the director of the McConnell Center. And it's been a pleasure of mine to be able to work with the students of the McConnell Scholars Program and many of you in the audience over the last 17 years. Over those years, we've had some of the most consequential leaders in America today that have been visited with us, spoken to us here at the University of Louisville. And I think today is no exception to that. We've been able to host, for instance, moments of historic importance, like Vice President Biden here the day that Mubarak resigned in Egypt. And we broke news and had some very important things happen on the Louisville tarmac that morning. Secretary of State Colin Powell delivers his first public policy address as Secretary of State here at the McConnell Center in 2001, just after 9/11. David Petraeus gave his only public speech as CIA director here at the McConnell Center, and many of you were here for some of those events. Today, I think at this important moment in American history, we will make history again by having the two leaders of the United States Senate here today on a very important day in the United States Senate. Ladies and gentlemen, would you please rise and help me welcome the interim president of the University of Louisville, Greg Postol, the majority leader of the United States Senate, Mitch McConnell, and the Democrat leader of the United States Senate, Chuck Schumer.
Good morning. Thank you so much, Dr. Gregg, for the introduction and for all of your hard work orchestrating this event. Leaders McConnell and Schumer, and all in attendance, on behalf of the students, faculty, and staff, and alumni of the University of Louisville, it's my sincere pleasure to welcome you here this morning. Thank you for braving the slick roads to attend this much-anticipated event. Universities and colleges benefit in so many ways from their graduates. Some distinguish themselves in their personal and professional careers and thereby increase the influence of their universities. Others continue to give to their alma mater, giving their time, talent, and treasure to be sure that the missions and the principles of the university are able to go forth and be bolstered. We're happy to say that the person I am privileged to introduce this morning falls into both categories. Leader Mitch McConnell graduated with honors from the University of Louisville with a degree in political science in 1964, and then went on to receive his law degree from the University of Kentucky in 1967. In 1977, he was elected to his first of two terms as Jefferson County Judge Executive, a post he held until 1985 when he was elected to the United States Senate. He has served continuously since that time and is Kentucky's senior senator. From 2007 until 2015, he served as the minority leader in the Senate, and then since 2015 has served as the Senate's majority leader. Those who know Mitch McConnell know that he is truly passionate about his alma mater. The cornerstone of his legacy is the McConnell Center, which today is managed beautifully by Gary Gregg, who you met earlier this morning. The mission of the McConnell Center is to identify, recruit, and nurture Kentucky's next generation of leaders. The values are those of leadership, scholarship, and service. The McConnell Scholars Program is home to 40 of the brightest undergraduate students in the state of Kentucky who are selected for their ability and their distinguished high school careers and who have an opportunity to study honors courses, participate in key programs to develop leadership capabilities, and also do some of their study abroad. The McConnell Center also is home to the public lecture series, which we enjoy this morning. The idea is to invite influential political leaders, business executives, and accomplished scholars to the college campus to help enrich and inform the campus community. Senator McConnell has been very clear about his desire to bring to this series a wide variety of speakers over the years who represent many disciplines and many philosophies so as to make sure that the dialogue is diverse, which of course is in keeping with the goals of a university. So with that said, my sincere gratitude to Leader Mitch McConnell, and I welcome him this morning as he introduces today's keynote speaker.
Well, thank you very much, Greg, and I also want to express my gratitude on behalf of all of us affiliated with U of L for your service as acting president here, and you've done, in my view, a seamless job of plugging the gap in this period we've had here between presidents. And I also want to single out Gary Gregg. When this program started in the early 90s, I really had no idea it could develop into what it has become. And Gary, you're the reason for that, and I thank you. Gary came here in 2000 and took it to a whole new level. And I hope you'll join me in thanking Gary Gregg for the great job he's done. We've had a lot of interesting speakers here over the years. In my view, none more interesting than our guest this morning. Chuck Schumer, of course, is from Brooklyn, born and raised. His dad owned an exterminator business, and one of Chuck's siblings remembered that we always associated the smell of Triple X roach spray with love. It was his hard work, day in and day out, that took this kid from Brooklyn to the world's greatest deliberative body, the United States Senate. It's also why last year Time Magazine named him one of the, to its distinguished list of 100 most influential people. After graduating from Harvard Law School, Chuck was elected to the New York State Assembly at the age of 23. About the same age as the graduates from this program. In his memoir, Chuck remembered his parents actually didn't want him to run. They thought the life of a corporate lawyer would be respectable and more comfortable. Well, Chuck, I've got to say that my life would have been a lot easier if you don't listen to your parents. Since that first electoral victory, he's kept a perfect batting average, never losing a single election. Came to Congress in 1981 and has served in both the House and the Senate, earning a reputation for tireless effort on behalf of the people of New York. A lot of people talk about working hard, but Chuck has taken it to a whole new level. I mean, there is nobody that works harder than this guy. The Washington Post once wrote, "Work has always been Schumer's ace in the hole. Members of Congress have said they supported Schumer's pet bills in part because he just wouldn't quit pestering them." When the Senate convened for the 115th Congress at the beginning of last year, He became the first New Yorker ever to serve as Senate Democratic leader. Chuck still lives in Brooklyn with his wife, Iris, a very accomplished woman in her own right, I might add. And no matter how much time he spends in Washington, he never lets anybody forget where he's from. Now, in our jobs, in our leadership roles, I get to work closely with him every single day. We negotiate the legislative schedule, nominations, and other important public policy matters before the Senate. As majority and minority leaders, we're kind of like the offensive and defensive coordinators. I've had both roles. As Coach Petrino can tell you, offensive coordinator is better. Washington may look like a pretty divided place. And in fact, I often think they teach them in journalism school that only conflict is news. But actually, the Senate is a pretty collegial place. We don't dislike each other. We have to work together. And we have a long history of robust debates over the history of this country. I have to remind students from time to time that anything you may have heard us say about each other pales in comparison to what Adams and Jefferson said about each other. And we have met a single incident where a congressman from South Carolina came over and almost beat to death a senator from Massachusetts with a cane. So robust debate is not unusual. It's been going on in this country for a very long time. But at every critical moment in this country, we've come together to do what needed to be done to move the ball down the field. Now, a lot of people probably look at Chuck and me and conclude something very different. But in fact, it's a great tradition of Senate leaders working together. In 1990, George Mitchell and Bob Dole worked together to pass the Americans with Disabilities Act. Trent Lott and Tom Daschle wrote a book together after they left the Senate in the early 2000s. One of the most visible ways that Chuck and I are seen together is every day when the Senate floor opens for business. After the prayer and the Pledge of Allegiance, each of us has the opportunity to offer opening remarks detailing our views of the business of the day. Traditionally, I speak first, followed by the Democratic leader. But now that we have this show on the road, I'm the warm-up act, and I am thrilled to have my good friend, the Democratic leader of the Senate, here this morning. Join me in welcoming Chuck Schumer.
Thank you. Thank you, everybody. So it's so great to be here with you. What a wonderful room. And thank you, Mitch, for that kind and generous introduction. We really do get along. Despite what you read in the press. Now, as Mitch will tell you, I like to always start off with a little story, a little joke. My colleagues sometimes say no one laughs harder at my jokes than I do. So this is a story. It's actually dedicated to my parents. I am blessed. My dad is 94. My mom is 89. Praise God. And my dad, as Mitch mentioned, struggled his whole life. He had this little exterminating business. It wasn't very successful. But when at age 70 he retired, my brother, who is a corporate lawyer and the financially successful Schumer, bought them a little house in Florida. So every winter they'd drive in their car down to Florida. They had a great time. My dad never had played golf before. He took up golf. They'd see their friends who were down there. And they had a good time. But as they got older, things changed a little bit. My dad couldn't play golf anymore. And many of their friends passed on, so they needed something to do. So Florida Atlantic University offers any senior citizen is allowed to take a course for free. So my parents enrolled in the course called Humor. Now, what was that? Every Thursday at 4 p.m., they'd roll up to Florida Atlantic University, go to the course called Humor, and what was it? Some erstwhile comedian who never made it in the Catskills would get up and tell jokes for 45 minutes, a different one each week. My dad never went to college. He said, gee, college is pretty easy. I should have gone. But in any case, they'd call me each week with their favorite joke, so this is one of them. Mrs. Walters is brought before the judge, and the judge rolls his eyes. Mrs. Walters, you're back. Yes, Your Honor, I'm back. And what did you steal this time, Mrs. Walters? Your Honor, I stole a can of peaches from the supermarket down the road. The judge is clearly exasperated. He said, look, Mrs. Walters, I know you're a kleptomaniac. I know it's an illness. I know you can't help yourself. I know you can easily afford a can of peaches. But for Lord's sake, this is March. You've been arrested for shoplifting 17 times already. And I have no choice but to sentence you to some time in jail. Now, how many peaches were in the can, Mrs. Walters? Your Honor, there were 4 peaches in the can. And I have no choice. I'm going to sentence you to 4 nights in jail, 1 for each peach. He's about to bang the gavel and pronounce sentence when a gentleman in the middle of the courtroom gets up all excited and agitated. Your Honor, he said, may it please the court, I'm her husband. She also stole a can of peas. So when you students all get old enough to retire and move to Florida, you can enroll in at Florida Atlantic University and call your children and regale them with jokes. Anyway, it's great to be here. And I want to recognize at the beginning this incredible group of young scholars. You are going to have a positive and lasting impact on your state, on your country. Give yourselves a round of applause. You are our future. In fact, Mitch, the scholars are so good, I recruit them. One of the wonderful McConnell scholars, Jasper Noble, will be an intern in my DC office this summer. Jasper, stand up. Are you here? Credit also goes, of course, to the great director of the McConnell Center, Gary Gregg, who's done an outstanding job at the helm for almost 2 decades. And finally, I'd like to thank my friend, and he truly is, my friend Mitch McConnell for this gracious invitation. I really respect and appreciate what Mitch and his wife Elaine have accomplished here at the McConnell Center, nurturing the next generation of bright Kentucky leaders. In New York, particularly in upstate New York, I've worked hard to support our network of world-class public universities and tried to attract companies that would keep the young students in New York once they graduated. That is indeed just what the McConnell Center does, among other things, for Kentucky. And you should be very, very proud. Now, much of the coverage about Mitch McConnell and me, as he mentioned, focuses on the differences between us and the 2 states we represent. But the truth is, there are plenty of things that link Mitch's hometown of Louisville with my hometown of Brooklyn. Take basketball, for instance. I know Mitch is a huge fan of his alma mater. Every Monday I'd come back and say, how's Louisville doing? Where are they in the rankings? I don't ask him this year as much. But I didn't want to miss this opportunity that 2 of the 3 Louisville basketball teams ever to win a national championship were led by New Yorkers. In 1980, it was the McRae brothers, Rodney and Scooter, from Mount Vernon in Westchester County. In 2013, it was Kevin Ware and Russ Smith from the Bronx in Brooklyn. And this year's team forward, Jordan Wara, is from the great city of Buffalo. So you never know. Now, here's another thing you might not realize we have in common, bourbon. It turns out that Brooklyn, where I was born, raised, and still proudly live, produces some of the best bourbon in the world. I know that's a contentious thing to say in these parts, but I think it's true. Now, this particular bourbon. Widow Jane is distilled right around the apartment, right around the corner from the apartment where I've lived. My wife Iris and I have lived for more than 30 years. It's filtered through the same limestone that was used to build some of New York's iconic structures, from the Brooklyn Bridge to the Statue of Liberty. And as a thank you for his invitation, I'd like to give this bottle to Widow Jane. Now, Mitch and I don't agree on a lot of things. As you just heard, I'm sure he'll never agree that New York bourbon even counts as bourbon. But when we need to come together to solve our country's problems and most pressing issues, we can and do successfully work together. As the longest serving leader of the Senate Republican Caucus, he understands the pressure that every leader faces, including me. I'm new at the job. We try our best to understand each other, to never ask things that are impossible of the other, to be honest and respectful, to work in good faith, and try to meet the middle wherever possible. Now, that's how we get things done in the Senate. Sometimes it doesn't happen. It's no secret I didn't agree with the way health care and tax legislation were considered in the Senate, for example. But sometimes it does happen. Late last week, for instance, in the early hours of Friday morning, the Senate passed a two-year budget deal that provides significant investments in our military and in our middle class, including funding to fight the opioid epidemic, improve veterans' health care, and relieve the student loan debt burden that so many young people carry with them. It's a significant achievement, a genuine bipartisan breakthrough. And it showed that even in very divisive political climate, the Senate can be the place where the business of the nation gets done. Last April, Mitch and I cut our first budget deal. We then passed a package of sanctions against President Putin for his interference in our 2016 election. And now we have this two-year budget agreement, which hopefully will lead the way. Mitch is an appropriator. They never let me on the Appropriations Committee. That we can do appropriation bills throughout this year and the next, where genuine bipartisanship happens every day. We have proven the Senate can function when both parties work in a bipartisan way and endeavor to forego compromises. This week, the Senate will have an opportunity to build on that progress. The Senate is poised to take up one of the very most contentious of issues, immigration. Leader McConnell, to his credit, has promised an open process that's fair to both sides. Democrats and Republicans are laboring to find a bill to protect the Dreamers and provide border security and garner 60 votes. It won't be easy, but we're all going to try because of the gravity of the issues at stake, and because we know that this week will be a test of whether the Senate can steer the ship of state through the stormiest of waters. Now, I believe it can. We've shown that the Senate can lead before, and it must do so again. The House is fractious. The President is the President. It is the Senate, that has the potential to act as a beacon of stable leadership and progress in a political culture plagued by gridlock and division and rancor. We have a special obligation to this country. The Senate, where each individual senator is empowered, where the rights of the minority are not only respected but cherished, where the rules make bipartisanship not just a goal but practically a necessity. It is the Senate, we all know what President Washington called it, the cooling saucer for the hot tea of politics, that can lead the Senate through difficult times. If there was ever a time when our politics needed a cooling saucer, it is now. That's what our history teaches us. We begin this week on immigration, but I'm sure it won't be the last issue on which the leadership in the Senate is required. I am hopeful that the same spirit that led Mitch and I to a budget deal, that spirit of bipartisanship and compromise, of putting country before party, will lead us through immigration and the many challenges to come. Now, as you know, Abe Lincoln said the best thing for politicians to do is tell stories, and I like to do that. When you're around as long as I've been, you got a whole lot of them. So I thought I'd tell you, I'd conclude by telling you young folks how I got into politics. It's the question I get most asked when I go to campuses. Mitch just came out with a book that documents his journey into politics, so it's only fair. Unlike many of you and unlike Mitch, as a high school senior, I had no idea that politics would end up being my life. I went to a working class high school in Brooklyn, James Madison High School. As I mentioned, my father was an exterminator, didn't go to college. But from that working class high school in 1967, I got into Harvard. That didn't happen very often. I got in for two reasons. I was a decent, not great, basketball player. At Madison, we weren't that good, Mitch. Our team's motto at Madison is, we may be small, but we're slow. But second, I had to get a job when I was 14 to help my family. And there was a Madison High School teacher advertising for somebody to run something called a mimeo machine. How many of you young people have ever heard of it? No, neither had my daughters. But there was a day before Xerox machines, and you would type a stencil and put it on a clunky machine with rollers and churn it. Well, I got the job. Now, what was the new business this Madison High School teacher was starting? He had this brilliant idea. He was going to prepare students for the SATs. What was his name? Kaplan. 30 years later, in a great American success story, he sold the business to the Washington Post for tens of millions of dollars. But I went and worked there, and nights, weekends, holidays, I'd work the machine. The second year, the business took off, so we got an electric machine, and as the machine went around and around and around, I read the preparatory materials over and over and over, and I took 5 tests, and I got 4 800s. So, the guidance counselor says, you should apply to Harvard. You're an athlete with 800s. I did, and I got in, but I was scared, because no one like me went to Harvard in those days. It was 80% private schools. And so I went to the one guy from my high school who had gone to Harvard before me, and I said, he was a basketball player, and I said, how am I going to make it at this place? He says, try out for the freshman basketball team. They're terrible, so you'll make it. And he said, and those will be your friends, you know, who you'll hang out with. So it's the fourth day of school or so, tryouts, and we're wearing these little numbers. Coach calls me up. Number 27, yes, sir. You're Schumer. Yes, sir. Oh, you went to Madison. Yes, sir. How's Coach so-and-so? He's fine, sir. Then he looks at me quizzically. He said, you play forward? I said, yes, sir. He said, how tall are you? I said, I'm 6'1", sir. He said, can you dribble? I said, that's not my strong suit, sir. He said, go home. He didn't watch me touch a ball. I was distraught, wrote my mom a note saying, I told you I should have gone to Brooklyn College. I'm coming home Monday. Fate, God's hand. That night, someone knocks on my door. How would you like to join the Harvard Young Democrats? We're working for a man named Eugene McCarthy, who is running in the New Hampshire primary against Lyndon Johnson on the basis that the Vietnam War was a mistake. Well, I didn't have a political bone in my body. My father was a Republican, my mother was a Democrat. But I was against the war, so I said, okay. And the next morning, I got on a bus and went up to New Hampshire with a whole bunch of kids from the whole Boston area, and I loved it. It was like sports. We'd divide up neighborhoods, write our own leaflets, knock on the doors. We had a great time. It was so good that I was given a high title in the McCarthy campaign in the Nashua, New Hampshire office because they had 2 mimeo machines, and I knew how to run them. It was a ramshackle campaign. But if you remember your history, McCarthy didn't quite win the primary. He came within 3-4 points. But Lyndon Johnson, a man who I admire, in an act, a rare act of humility, saw the handwriting on the wall, said the country's against me, and a week later said, I'm not going to run. And I said to myself, wow, a group of students and other assorted nobodies, a ramshackle campaign, and we topple the most powerful man in the world? What a system we have. This is what I want to dedicate my life to. And so for the rest of my days, I've been interested in politics, as Mitch mentioned, and have been an elected official since I've been 23. And my dad, he would pace the floor Sunday nights in his little exterminating business. My brother, sister, and I would hear him, because he hated going to work Monday morning. To this day, I wake up Monday morning, just about every Monday morning, and I love going to work. Thank you very much for the opportunity to address you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Senator. Thank you, Senator Schumer. Senator Schumer has agreed to take some questions. I know from your audience that you've turned in cards, and Mary Kate Lindsay and Hannah Wilson will take turns asking questions.
Great.
Mary Kate.
Good morning, Senator. Thanks for being here.
I don't see where you are, Mary Kate.
I'm right here.
Ah, there you are. Okay.
First question from the audience. There has been talk of a blue wave of Democrats winning seats in the 2018 midterms. If this is to happen, what are the biggest obstacles Democrats must overcome before that time?
Well, I think that our goal, and I have said this publicly, I think in 2016 we didn't do enough of this. People will have their make their own decisions about Donald Trump. And we do know that in off-year elections, it's often a referendum on the president. Right now, his popularity levels are rather low, particularly in lots of states and districts where there are contested races. But our mistake, I think, you cannot just run against Donald Trump. And it is the job of we Democrats to put together a strong, cohesive economic group of proposals aimed at the middle class and those struggling to get there. There's a lot of discontent in America. People don't have faith in the future. In other words, even at the heights, I read this somewhere, even at the heights of the Great Depression, where median income went much lower than it did in the last 10 years, although median income is down in real dollars, that people had more hope for the future. That's our job as Democrats. We have always been the party of economic advancement. And I think we may have lost some sight of that. So we've proposed a whole bunch of proposals, three of which actually partially got into the budget agreement that Mitch and I came to and the Senate and House voted on, the President signed. One, to help begin reduce the costs of the of student loans that so many of you will carry on your backs. Two, rural broadband. Franklin Roosevelt said in the 30s that every rural home should get electricity. It was a necessity, and he set up the REA. We Democrats believe that every rural home should have broadband, and we are endeavoring to do that, and there's an initial amount of money to start doing that in the country. And third, child care. These days, with so many families where both parents work, or single-parent families, it's very hard to work. What do you do with the kids? You want good child care for your children. And we've more than doubled the amount that went into the Bipartisan Child Care Act that was passed by Lamar Alexander, one of Mitch's good friends, and my good friends in the Senate of Tennessee, a Republican, and Patty Murray, Democrat of Washington. So that's what we have to focus like a laser on. Very important for the country, as well as for winning back the seats in the House and Senate.
Thank you, Senator. Thank you for your time this morning. This person would like to know, do you feel there is a lack of servant leadership in politics today, and would you please define what you think a servant leader is?
Well, I really don't know what a servant leader is. I guess that's in a book somewhere, right? Who wrote the question? What is a servant leader? Got it. Well, yes, I think that All too often in our politics today, talk is replaces action. That's not a good thing. And to have people who, the people I think, the Senate is an interesting place. It's only 100 people, and I like to tell my colleagues, you really get look into the souls of people. You get to see who they are. It's very hard in a body that works so closely with so few members, you know, to hide who you are. And I think the senators that have the most respect are actually the people who get things done, not the people who make the most, you know, flamboyant or even fine speeches. And so I think that role has always been important. In these days, with so much press magnification of small and trivial things, it's less apparent to the public. But that ultimate value of being a servant leader is very, very important. And I think we have a whole good bunch of them in the Senate. Thank you. And if you ask me who, every one of my colleagues, of course.
Thank you. Automation is a challenge in the changing economy. As automation increases into the 21st century, we may see fewer jobs. What do you believe is the answer for this?
That's a great question. I think many of us of both political parties, of all political spectrums, struggle with this. And it's a very, very difficult issue. Now, it's not certain that efficiency and automation will reduce jobs. Some have argued, some economists, that it will actually increase jobs. You know, the classic they give is Amazon knocks out a lot of small stores, but then hires loads of people in their warehouses and people to work there. But I think it's a real worry, not just of leadership, but of the average American. How are my kids going to have a good paying job? And this is a very difficult issue that I haven't heard good answers to. But I do think, and I don't know how to get there, I began thinking about this, that certain jobs, you see, I'm going to take a minute on this. In an ideas economy, wealth tends to agglomerate to the top. Not through any political reason, it's just plain economics. So I like to tell my constituents that the two bookends of the 20th century were Henry Ford and Bill Gates. Each mass-produced a major product that was very, very much needed by the country, cars, computer platform. Each became multi-billionaire because of it, as they should. Americans believe, and I think it's a good thing about our country, that when you create a great new idea, you become very wealthy. That inspires others to struggle to find great new ideas. But here's the difference between Ford and Gates. Ford created, so to speak, these are just, you know, numbers for example, they may not be exactly accurate. But Ford created a million jobs where people for the first time made $10,000 a year. He made something. So you needed people to make the cars, to fix the cars, to service the cars, to transport the cars. Bill Gates's addition to society, mass producing a computer platform, was equally important. But because it was fundamentally an idea, I mean, I know you sent them, you put that box called Windows in there, but it was an idea. So he created 10,000 people, so to speak, figuratively speaking, who made $1 million a year for the first time. How do we deal with that issue? Because in an ideas economy, particularly where ideas can be transmitted at no cost because of the internet, wealth will continue unabated to agglomerate to the top. It's one of the differences Mitch and I had on the tax bill, and part of my skepticism was because of what I'm telling you. One thing we may be exploring, there are certain jobs that will be more and more important in society that add human dignity and human grace and help, and we should think about how we might transform them so they garner more pay and more respect. One for me would be teacher. But another, which people haven't thought of, is people who take care of the elderly. We're all going to have more elderly people. We're going to have to work longer given the diminution of our workforce. Who's going to take care of these people? And maybe it shouldn't be a job where you just get paid the lowest possible wage because it adds so much. Those are hardly complete answers, but it's a place where I'm beginning to think about.
Thank you. Okay, our next question. How do you feel about the possibility of instituting congressional term limits?
I'm against them. I'm better at this job today than I was 5 years ago. And you wouldn't have term limits for other jobs that demand certain skills. You wouldn't say a surgeon at the top of his or her game should stop doing surgery, or a ball player should keep playing as long as they're really good. I'd rather it be by the merits and let the public make the judgment than instill term limits. There are other things I do to make incumbency less successful, if you will, particularly campaign finance reform, but I don't think term limits is the answer.
Thank you. The Constitution did not originally foresee the role party leadership would play in Congress. How have you personally interpreted your responsibility and adapted your leadership style to define your role both in your party and in the Senate?
You know, the two are sort of the same, and I think Mitch would agree with this. The number one thing a good leader can, we have very diverse parties. He has, say, Susan Collins and Ted Cruz. We won't say Rand Paul here in Kentucky. I have Bernie Sanders and Joe Manchin. And I think what makes us most successful and helps us represent broadly all of America is to try and create unity in our caucuses. I really endeavor, and each of us, it's a very interesting moment. I think it's one of the highlights of being senator. Every Tuesday, we have caucuses. It's within our own party. But they're really open discussions. Less frequently than you'd think, what happens in these discussions sort of leaks out, so people are quite candid. And I make an effort to tell my caucus that, you know, we have to understand each other. And we may not agree with each other on every issue, but if we could work together in a unified way, and that applies within the Democratic Party and between the Democratic and Republican parties, we do a lot better. So the role of party as a unifier, in a certain sense, in a divided and fractious country where things are more atomized than ever, can actually be a unifier, not a separator. And I see that as one of the very most important roles I have as party leader, to try and get my entire caucus to work together. And this year we've had a good deal of success doing that.
Thank you. In light of decreased funding for the EPA, how do you plan to protect our air and water quality given catastrophes like Flint, Michigan?
Well, I agree with you that the idea of removing so many people from the EPA doesn't make sense. Most Americans believe in clean water and clean air. We've seen what happens when we don't have it, and just in terms of life expectancy. The fact that our air is cleaner and our water is cleaner, life expectancy is considerably higher, and that's the most important thing to most people. You know, God's most precious gift to us is life itself. And so I think that it's important that these regulations, which help enforce clean air and clean water, make sense. There are things called externalities. You do something that makes the air dirtier or makes the water dirtier, it doesn't hurt you necessarily, but it hurts thousands, tens of thousands, millions of people. And economists have always searched for a way that we can capture externalities. And, you know, in a very broad sense, clean air and clean water are supposed to capture some of those externalities, and I think they're a good thing. We Democrats have endeavored in the budget of 2017, which we passed, and in this budget of 2018, where we'll be debating what's called the omnibus, the details of the budget agreement we came to make sure that there aren't severe cuts to the number of employees in EPA. Obviously, and Mitch and I would disagree with this, I don't think Pruitt is doing the country a service by eliminating the employees or too many of these, regulations.
Thank you. Should individuals who enlist in the military be guaranteed a certain accelerated path to citizenship?
Well, you know, the broad issue of immigration reform, one of the moments I was proudest of in the Senate was when John McCain, who's a great man and we pray for his health, and I led the so-called Gang of Eight, four Democrats, four Republicans, pretty broad range of views in terms of ideology, and we put together a comprehensive immigration reform bill. And that was a very, very fine bill that did most of the things you hear 80% of the people talking about. We want a path to citizenship for our people. We want secure borders. We want to admit, you know, some of the people from abroad who come here and study in science, we want to let them stay here because they can create new jobs and fill new things. We need to have agriculture workers because we don't have enough of them native, you know, people who are from America originally. Was in that bill. And it was a very good bill. And in that bill, we wouldn't debate, you know, we provided a path to citizenship for the 11 million, not just the Dreamers, which we're talking about now. Now, you know, some labeled it amnesty. It was not amnesty. Here's what you had to do to become a citizen. You had to work. You had to pay back taxes. You had to pledge loyalty to the United States. You had to pay a fine and admit wrongdoing. And then you had to go to the back of the line. So if somebody crossed the border, illegally in 2007, but someone else had, say, Mexican, someone else had waited at the embassy in 2006 patiently, the 2006 person would get in ahead of the 2007 person. When Americans hear that, oh, you had to learn English to get a green card for the first time. When Americans hear this, they say, I'm for it, 80% of them. But unfortunately, some in the media world, I'll say it, the hard right, labeled this amnesty, and that sort of stuck, but it is not amnesty at all. So I would hope we could, President Trump has actually said to me a whole bunch of times, I don't know if he said it to you, Mitch, but he said, I'd like to do comprehensive immigration reform. And maybe, 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 who knows, if we get past this Dreamers issue successfully and are able to help the Dreamers, we might be able to go back to that.